Hello and welcome to, I welcome all the students of Target Educare to the lecture on oral and maxillofacial surgery. I am Dr. Prajwalit Kende. I am associate professor and I am heading the department of oral and maxillofacial surgery, Government Dental College and Hospital, Mumbai. Before starting the lecture, I just wanted to tell you about the pattern of examinations, different examinations which are taken in India. Now we have different examination, as you all must be aware of, like All India Entrance Examination. Then we have examinations, PGD CET examination, PGA Chandigarh. Then we have AIIMS and so on. Now mostly the big examinations, like we have Manipal or postgraduate and PGI Chandigarh or All India Entrance, all the examinations they check the aptitude of the student by a qualitative tool which is called as a multiple choice question, or we call it as MCQ. Now there are two types of tools which can be used to assess the student. First is a quantitative tool and second is qualitative tool. In quantitative tool, as you all know, we ask about the theory questions like long answer questions, short answer questions, or fill in the blanks and so on. But if I want to assess, if I am a teacher and if I want to assess a large sample of students, say 1 lakh or 2 lakh or 10 lakh students, and then we use a qualitative tool like multiple choice question. Now you must be wondering why I am telling you all this, because for entrance examination, to have subject knowledge is not adequate, because apart from the subject knowledge, you should also have the knowledge of what are these multiple choice questions, how are these multiple choice questions are formed by the examiner, and how these multiple choice questions should be attacked or should be answered in a proper way, so that you will not make a mistake. Because many times what happens, a student has good knowledge of the subject, but if he or she doesn't know how to answer the multiple choice question, then he might do wrong in their examination. And believe me, negative marking, many of the examination we have a negative marking, and in such case, in overconfidence, when we mark any response or the key and then it becomes wrong, we have minus 1/4 negative, and you may lose a seat of orthodontics or maxillofacial surgery and or so on. So even 1/4 mark. Yes. There's an announcement. Like if you have any query or if you have any problem in viewing the lecture or in listening the lecture, then you may directly call the helpline which is provided to you. Thank you. So I was talking about the multiple choice questions. So if I am an examiner, now basically what is a multiple choice question? So multiple choice question is nothing but a qualitative tool which is used to assess a large sample size. Now what are the components of multiple choice question? It will just take 5 minutes to tell you about this, but it will be very helpful to you when you are giving your entrance examination. So when first we have a direction is, for example, we mark the best response. Mark the best response is a direction, or pick up any true statement out of the following. Now this is a direction which is given by the examiner to the student. Then we have a stem or the base of the question. For example, I'll tell you, the most commonest microorganism to cause subacute bacterial endocarditis is. Now this is called as the stem of the MCQ or the base of the MCQ. and then the examiner has four options. One is option A, B, C or D. We call it as options or we call it as choices. Now apart from these four choices, a student has to pick up, the correct choice or a correct alternative or a correct key. Okay, so examiner has four options, option A, option B, option C, option D. So examiner has to put the key somewhere in A, B, C or D. Now if I am an examiner, what I will try to do is I will try to confuse the students. Okay, now the other three options, they are called as distractors. These distractors are meant to distract the students from the right answer. Okay, now when I am an examiner, if I am an examiner, I will try to put the key somewhere in A, B, C or D. Now many examiners, they have the psychology that if the student starts reading the stem of the MCQ or the base of the MCQ, and if the examiner puts the key in option A, student ko thoda jaldi pata chal jayega answer. So some examiners don't put it in A, then they try to put it in D, but again some students are very mischievous. They will start looking at the options from down, that is they'll read D first and then C, then B, then A. So again the examiner doesn't put it in D. So many times the examiner tries to put the alternative or the key of the answer in option C. So many times it happens, but this you can only try to mark only C as the answer when there is no negative marking. When you have there are 100 MCQs, you have already solved 90 and there are only 2 minutes left. In that case where there is a no negative marking, then in those cases other 10 questions you mark option C. Many times it becomes correct and it will click, it may click. So that you can use, but mind well, if it is there is a negative marking, then you should not use this technique. So this is how the MCQs are framed. Now there are various types of multiple choice questions which are there, which have been taught to us in our teacher training program. Now there are single best response type of MCQs, then we have question based type of MCQ, then we have negative type of MCQ, direct, simple completion type or case history type. Now the single best response type. Now this is the most common variety of multiple choice question which is being asked in your entrance examination, or mostly they ask you this type of multiple choice question. Now single best response type means whenever there is a direction, if you read the direction, they have already always write there, mark the best response. Marking the best response means that out of the four alternatives which are given to you below the stem, there might be more than one correct answer to the stem or to the question. You have to mark the best thing. So because I am telling you all this, because this will really help you while you are giving your entrance examination. You have to mark the best response. So for example, I will tell you as I have told you one example, the most commonest microorganism to cause subacute bacterial endocarditis is, then we have four options, like we have Staphylococci aureus, Streptococci and E. coli and so on. Suppose four options are there. Now if you see Staphylococci as well as Streptococci, both cause subacute bacterial endocarditis, but Streptococci is the most commonest microorganism which causes subacute bacterial endocarditis. Now in my examination in All India entrance, I have marked Staphylococci, so I had -1/4 negative marking in, I have -1/4 mark which were deducted, and I have to lose a seat of orthodontics. Okay, so this actually happens, and that's why you have to read the stem of the MCQ thrice. This is what I will tell you, always read the question, always read the stem of the MCQ thrice. So single best response, so you have to mark the best response. I'll come to that, why you should read the stem of the MCQ thrice. But single best response means you have to mark the best response out of the responses which are given to you. Second is question based. There might be a question given, there will be a question mark ahead of it, and then you have to choose the option. Question based, negative. Now many questions you must have studied or read in several MCQ books. There is written except, E-X-C-E-P-E-T, except. Now beware of this terminology like accept, because in such cases what happens, in overconfidence and what we just don't read the stem of the MCQ properly, and then we forget about that accept, and we mark the answer and then we are wrong. So always remember and beware of these terminologies like accept. So if you ask accept, or some question is like, out of all of the following, all are the signs of signs and symptoms of inferior ulnar block, except means out of four, three are there but one is not there. Okay, so such questions where there is not is used, or except word is used, they are all negative type of questions. Then we have direct type of question. Direct type means like simple, like direct type of question. For example, I'll tell you who discovered xylocaine. So this is a direct type of question. Then we have simple completion type of question. Like simple completion is like a fill in the blanks. One statement is there and at the last the answer is there, but there is a fill in the blank, and then you, that is option A, B, C or D. You have to fit it in that blank, fill in the blank space. So that is a single completion type of MCQ. Then we have case history type of MCQ, where the patient's age is given, male or female is given, then some signs or symptoms are told to you, and then you have to make a diagnosis or give a diagnosis of the patient, or you have to the treatment of that particular condition you have to tell. And such questions are called as case history type of MCQs. Now, how to attack a MCQ. Now, MCQ is not your enemy to attack it, but when I say to attack the MCQ means you are answering the MCQ. Now, whenever you are in a battlefield, if you know your enemy well, then only you can try to and win the war. Okay, so you should know your enemy properly. You should know the positive points and negative aspects of your enemy, and then you can really win the war. So I don't treat MCQs as enemy, but this is just to tell you, okay, because if you treat any subject or anything is as your enemy, you will never win actually. Okay, now whenever you are trying to solve a MCQ, read the stem of the MCQ thrice. I'm telling you, read the MCQ stem thrice. Now why you need to read it thrice? As I have told you, there are various terminologies. I'm telling you most commonest. There are many times you must have read this terminology, most commonest. Out of the most commonest micro, as I have told you in my example, the most commonest microorganism to cause subacute bacterial endocarditis, the only thing I missed out in the stem was most commonest. So when I missed out most commonest, I missed out my orthodontic seat. So it's very simple thing, but you have to remember. So read the stem of the MCQ thrice. Secondly, once you read the stem of the MCQ thrice, what actually the examiner wants from you, that you should know. Okay, then you try to remove the distractors. Suppose there is one MCQ but you don't know the direct answer of that MCQ, then you try to remove the distractors from that four responses which are given to you by the examiner. So remove the distractors from the alternatives. I will be telling you one by one when we will see some multiple choice questions later on. And once you remove the distractors from the alternatives, then you arrive at a correct response, and then you mark the correct the key or the answer key. That is the way how you actually attack the MCQ or try to solve the multiple choice question. Now out of these three distractors, two distractors will be looking, or they seem to be the answer, okay, but they are not. And the third distractor is like, if a student goes with that third distractor, you will always go wrong. So this is how we actually set the multiple choice question. And now many times what happens, it depends upon the examiner also how he is. So now I'll just give you one example, that the maximum recommended dose, of local anesthesia with adrenaline is, the maximum recommended dose of local anesthesia with adrenaline is. Now there are four responses. One is 6.6 milligram per kg body weight, 7 milligram per kg body weight, 5 milligram per kg body weight, and 7.5 milligram per kg body weight. Now there are some examiners who read different types of books. Now one examiner reads monymes, the other examiner doesn't read monymes and he will read malamed. Okay. So in monymes it is given 6.6 milligram per kg body weight and in malamed it is given 7 milligram per kg body weight. Now again in such cases where both the answer and suppose you have read both the books, now you are confused what to mark, whether to mark 6.6 milligram per kg body weight or whether to mark 7 milligram per kg body weight. You don't know what book or the examiner must have read. So there are so many things, you know. Where you are not wrong, but you may become wrong because you don't know what the examiner actually wants. So when you read the stem of the MCQ, you read it thrice so that you know what exactly the examiner wants. Again, some examiners, they read literature, they read the articles and all. So they may pick up some questions, because I'll give you one example, general knowledge example, that the highest amount of production or the highest production of oranges is seen in which city? So A is Nagpur, Amravati, Akola and Buldhana, for example. This is your question. What will you mark? Now the old examiner knows about that, and everybody knows actually that Nagpur is the city which is known for the highest production of oranges. But if you see the literature, the recent literature, they have mentioned that not Nagpur but Amravati is the district which has the highest production of oranges. So if I am the examiner, I am reading the review or all the articles and everything, the recent literature, I will always keep in my mind that Amravati is the answer. But if the examiner is the old examiner, he might say he might give a key as Nagpur. But what the student should do, then again I keep my fingers crossed in such cases, because now it is not your mistake, it is not the examiner. So sometimes some questions might be like this. Then in exams where there is a negative marking, sometimes the examiner asks stupid type of question. Now stupid type of question means where there is no answer to the question. All the responses are distractors. Sometimes it happens, but nowadays the examiner don't put such type of questions. They are strictly disallowed by the examination board. But sometimes there might be, so you have to be very beware, and also be beware of such terminologies as I have told you, like except, most common, commonest, because, not, none of the above, all of the above. So wherever these terminologies you see when you are solving the multiple choice questions, always give a second thought, always be calm, read the stem of the MCQ thrice, see what actually the examiner wants, and then you try to solve the multiple choice question. So I believe that this small piece of information will be very helpful to you while you are solving the multiple choice questions. Now coming to the basic oral and maxillofacial surgery. Now we'll start with the multiple choice questions, and we have 200 multiple choice questions to get solved. So the first question is, you can just read this question, oral and maxillofacial surgery is defined as, it's a very straight, excuse me, it's a very straight type of multiple choice question, and a direct type of a multiple choice question, and they have given all the options. There are four options: diagnosis and treatment of head and face region, diagnosis and treatment of defects in orofacial region, both 1 and 2 and none of the above. Again, I am worried because here their option is none of the above. So whenever you see this such option, none of the above, all of the above, you have to be very careful. Okay. Now, oral and maxillofacial surgery, to be very specific, deals with the treatment and management, diagnosis, treatment and treatment of the defects in the orofacial region. It is because oral and maxillofacial surgery has some boundaries, but nowadays, you know, plastic surgery, there are so many other fields which are actually overlapped with the field of maxillofacial surgery. Like we have ENT surgeons, sometimes ENT surgeons also treat the cyst of the maxilla, they also treat the maxillary sinus. Then you have plastic surgeons, then we have neurosurgeons, we have neurosurgeons, and so on. So there are so many, then we have ophthalmic surgeons. So many things, they are overlapped or overlapping. But basically, if you see, the oral and maxillofacial surgery is defined as the diagnosis and treatment of defects in the orofacial region. So answer is B. Second question, oral and maxillofacial surgery essentially deals with, again I will read it twice, oral and maxillofacial surgery, I will underline this terminology, essentially. I have told you already that there are certain terminologies which you should be aware of whenever MCQ is asked. So, oral and maxillofacial surgery essentially deals with, it might deal with many things, but essentially it deals with simple extractions, detecting and management of oral cancer, pre-prosthetic surgery, all of the above. Again, all of the above here is the terminology. Many times whenever all of the above is the option, many times all of the above is the answer. 70% times all of the above is the answer. If I may be wrong, but if you must have read so many MCQ books, 70% of the times whenever there is a all of the above is the answer. Okay. And these are my simple observations which I think it might help you. So it essentially deals with, of course, simple extractions, detecting and management of oral cancer, pre-prosthetic surgery. Now, simple extraction and pre-prosthetic surgery is a part and parcel of maxillofacial surgery, but also as the word maxillofacial is there, detecting and management of oral cancer also comes into existence. So in such case, all of the above is the answer. So as precancerous lesions, detection, management of oral cancer, management of orofacial fin, reconstruction, nowadays not only doing the surgery is very important. In the past what happened was only if there is any pathology, you just operate, remove the pathology and close it, that's it. But nowadays it is not like that. Whenever a surgeon is trying to remove any pathology, you need to think of reconstruction first and then you should try to operate the patient on the patient. So whenever you, because whenever you operate on such cases like cancers and benign tumors, malignant tumors, there will be a defect. So what about reconstruction? How it will get reconstructed? How will you do a reconstruction? Now many times there are two types of reconstruction. One is immediate type of reconstruction. The other is delayed type of reconstruction. Now in Tata Memorial Hospital or whenever a cancer surgeon is operating on any cancer, maybe oral cancer for example, then once you remove the primary tumor, you need to send it to the oral pathology lab and take a frozen section, and in 10 to 15 minutes you will get whether all the margins of the tumor are clear or not. If they are clear, you can go for reconstruction at the same time in the same setting. But whenever you feel like that, or whenever a surgeon feels there might be some remnant of the tissue or the tumor cells or malignant cells, then you should always wait for 6 months, and after 6 months you should plan for reconstruction. This is called as delayed type of reconstruction. So there are two types of reconstruction, immediate type and that is this delayed type of reconstruction. Other than all those, we have maxillofacial surgeon treats extractions, I've told you cysts and tumors, and then we have traumatic injuries. Of course we have traumatic injuries of the mandible, then we have the maxillofacial area, salivary gland disease. Now you might know that ENT surgeon also operates on the parotid gland and the submandibular gland, the sublingual salivary gland. So there are so many things which are overlapping, but nowadays the maxillofacial surgery has crossed the leaps and bounds, and we do treat the external auditory meatus, your pinna, all the plastic surgical procedures with the we can take a craniofacial of the flaps, and we can take the cranial bone grafts and so on. So nowadays maxillofacial surgeons themselves, they are taking the iliac bone grafts, we have costochondral bone graft, and many surgeons they are taking fibula flap as well, a free vascular fibula flap. So the scope of maxillofacial surgery is increasing day by day. The third question, cielography is mostly used to detect. Now actually cielography, now again in this question the word you can see mostly is the word. So there might be more than two, but what cielography is mostly used to detect. So again, you have to be, it is made to confuse the students as well as the examiner. Now such questions are very confusing. Cielography is mostly used to detect ductal system of the major salivary gland, acinar system of the major salivary gland, both 1 and 2 and none of the above. Now in this question it is very simple that it is mostly used to detect both ductal system. It can be used for to see whether there is any salivary stone is present inside the duct or any obstruction is there inside the duct, or you can also see the acinar system of the salivary glands. So the answer is both 1 and 2. I want to just show you one radiograph here. Now you can see this is a lateral oblique view of the mandible and maxilla, or lateral, or you can also call it as a lateral skull view, but it is not lateral skull exactly. And here you can see there is one needle and a radio-opaque dye, iodine 131 is injected in the plica sublingualis, or the Bartholin's duct in the of the submandibular gland. And you can see the x-rays are taken, a series of radiographs are taken, and you can see the iodine is going through the duct and then into the acinar system. So like this you can see the acinar system as well as you can see the duct of the salivary gland, whether there is any obstruction or not. Pardon? Yeah, yeah, but what I do is I'll take 5 to 10 MCQs and then I'll see that, then I'll answer like that. Because every time if I try to do that, it will take a very long time. Well, somebody is asking me, we'll discuss only MCQs, ? I've been told that there was some examination of yours and I have to discuss MCQs, but at the same time, when I'm talking about that topic, I also cover that topic. Don't worry. Okay. Okay. So this is a CLO graphy. So CLO graphy, I have already told you, it's a radiographic technique which is used to detect and monitor the any problems if they are there in the major salivary glands. It is not used in the minor salivary gland, it is mostly used in the major salivary gland, and it has a it is used to detect any silolith, as I have told you, any stone formation inside the duct of the gland, or to evaluate the extent of ductal damage might be due to infection, or to evaluate or suspect any neoplasms of the salivary glands, and so on. Now one more thing I want to talk about salography is, now these are all the indications of doing salography, but we should also know what are the contraindications when salography should not be used. Now mind well, whenever there is an acute infection inside the gland or inside the duct, you should not use salography, because in such cases you may spread the inflammation or the infection. Secondly, if you suspect if there is any malignancy inside the duct or maybe inside the acini, you should not use salography because there might be metastasis of the malignant cells. And thirdly, if the patient is having any allergy to the drug which is used, like iodine, then it is an absolute contraindication. So these are the three absolute contraindications when you should not go for salography. Now what are the next questions? What are the advantage of CT scan? Okay, CT scan, they are also called as computerized tomography, and they are actually meant for greater precision. You can get a 3D view of the facial structures. Now earlier the CT scans, they used to show you 3D structures, but nowadays we have nowadays you can go for a 3D CT scan where you can see the actual skeleton, actual maxilla and the mandible, and the location of the fracture or any disease or any lesion on the 3D CT scan, and you can exactly locate the lesion where the lesion is, which is not cannot be appreciated in two-dimensional radiographs like the other your extraoral or conventional radiographs. So CT scan, the advantages are greater precision, 3D view of the facial structures, and exact localization of the problem or of the disease. So all of the above is the answer. So I have already told you advantages of CT scan over conventional radiograph. better visualization of the structures in various minute levels and planes. And the CT scans, actually they show you a difference between the blood and CSF, or blood fat or blood, and blood and CSF, or blood and fat, then your muscle and bone. But mind, well, CT scans are mostly used to see the any changes in the bone. Okay, if there are any changes inside the bone, CT scans are mostly used for heart tissues, and magnetic resonance imaging or MRI, they are used in for soft tissues. Okay, so if you feel that there might be some arteriovenous malformation or any blood hemangioma or something like that, then you should go for MRI. Even if you want to see any soft tissue, soft tissues are well appreciated on MRIs than your CT scan. So CT scans for heart tissue, MRI for soft tissue. For example, if you want to check the disc, articular disc of the temporomandibular joint, and then you should go for a MRI. Some student is asking me that what about for minor salivary gland. See, for minor salivary gland, the salivary glands are so minute that we can't use cielography, because there is no opening, there is no duct, so where will you go to inject it? So it's very difficult. So for minor salivary gland, cielography is not used. So for cielography is only used for major salivary glands and not for minor salivary glands. Okay. Next question is, the normal value of serum phosphorus is. Now the normal value, it's a very direct type of question. Okay. So here I don't know, but in such questions, whenever examiner is setting such questions, you have to come in a ascending order. Either the numericals are in ascending order, or they are in the descending order. But this MCQ, it is jumbling. So mostly it will be in ascending order or descending order. The answer is to the normal value of serum phosphorus is 2.5 to 4.5 milligram per 100 ml. It is 2.5 to 4.5 milligram per 100 ml. Now serum phosphorus levels, they increase in the body when there are some kidney problems are there. Suppose there is any kidney problem, the glomerular filtration rate is reduced. In such cases, the phosphorus will be there, seen in the more excess in the blood, and then the phosphorus level will increase. But in cases of hyperparathyroidism and all, the serum phosphorus level will reduce. So normal level is 2.5 to 4.5 milligram per 100 ml. Yes, here it is written, serum phosphorus increased levels are, also as I have told you, hypoparathyroidism, hyperparathyroidism caused by chronic renal failure, and the decreased levels are seen in hyperparathyroidism, malabsorption disease, and chronic antacid usage, vitamin D deficiency. Radionuclide. Now, radionuclide is again used for diagnosis purposes, and it's again a direct type of question, whether it has high specificity and low sensitivity, high sensitivity and high specificity, high sensitivity and low specificity, and none of the above. Actually, radionuclide has high sensitivity, but it has low specificity. Means sensitivity and specificity, these are two different terminologies. And radionuclide, if you see, it is more sensible it will give you the diagnosis, but it is not that specific that yes, this lesion is the same thing what we are suspecting. So 100% you cannot say that it has sensitivity, but it lacks specificity. So it has high sensitivity and low specificity. Yeah, they have explained here, the technique of radionuclide imaging has high sensitivity and low specificity. It can detect early silent lesions, so they are good sensitive, but that they cannot be completely visualized on the radiograph. That's why we will say it as having low specificity. Now next MCQ is normal value of BUN. That is, BUN is nothing but blood, urea, nitrogen. Again, it's a direct type of MCQ. Normal value of blood, urea, nitrogen is 10 to 20 milligrams per 100 ml. So it's a direct type of MCQ, that is the normal value of blood urea nitrogen. Again, if you see that the blood urea nitrogen levels may be seen reduced in cases of liver disorders, and in cases of kidney disorders it might increase. Yes, here decreased levels are associated with advanced liver diseases, like we have a hepatotoxicity or we have cirrhosis of the liver. In such cases, because all this urea and nitrogen, it is formed in the liver, and suppose your liver is not working naturally inside the blood, the decreased level, because it is formed in the liver, so normally in the blood it will reduce, okay, because the liver cannot form. If the diseased liver is there, it cannot form urea and nitrogen, so in the blood the levels will be decreased. And in renal disorders, if it cannot pass through the glomerulus and the glomerular filtration rate is reduced, okay, and if there is any nephritis or some disease of the glomerulus, again it will increase because it cannot get excreted, so it will increase in the blood. Coming to the next question, punch biopsy. Punch biopsy is used in, now there are so many types of biopsy. We have exfoliative cytology. Exfoliative cytology is nothing but where we take the scrapings of the lesion, scrapings of the lesion, and then we just take it on directly on the slide and we see it or visualize it under the microscope. This is called as exfoliative cytology. Then we have incisional biopsy. Actually, incisional biopsy is done in cases where the lesion is more than 1 centimeter in diameter, and we do excisional type of biopsy where the whole lesion is removed if the lesion is less than 1 centimeter in diameter. And then there are other types of biopsy, like we have aspiration biopsy, then we have fine needle aspiration cytology. So there are so many types of, then we have punch biopsy. Now here they have asked about punch biopsy. Now punch biopsy, there is one instrument which is used for doing the biopsy. It is like a punch. Punch means it will just go onto that area and it will take out some the tissue and it will come out. We can take it out. Now punch biopsy is basically used to take biopsy from inaccessible areas. Like suppose patient is having oral submucous fibrosis, patient cannot open the mouth, patient is having trismus, but you need to take a biopsy from retromolar pad area or retromolar region. Now, in such cases these punch biopsies are done. But in such case the disadvantage of doing or taking punch biopsy is that the tissue may get destructed or the tissue may get destroyed. So again, under the microscope there might be, you know, 100% you cannot get the proper result of the punch biopsy. So but punch biopsy should be avoided. But in cases where the area is inaccessible, and in such case you cannot do the incisional biopsy, so here in we can use or we can do the punch biopsy technique. So punch biopsy is used in specimen from inaccessible areas, and where the areas are accessible, of course wherever the areas are accessible, then you can go for incisional biopsy, which will be more clearer or more better than the doing the punch biopsy. I have already told you about this punch biopsy. Now, which of the cytological method uses scrapings from epithelial surface? Again, I have already explained you that this is nothing but exfoliative cytology. In exfoliative cytology, we take a slide and we can take the scrapings of the lesion, and some cells which are there on the top, they will come on the slide. You fix the slide and then you just see it under the microscope. That is exfoliative cytology. Next is fine needle aspiration cytology. Fine needle aspiration cytology is a technique which is uses around 19 gauge needle, 18 to 19 gauge needle, which is also called a Silverman's needle. And this needle is pierced inside the lesion, and you aspirate the contents, and then some cells we get aspirated. Some cells they come on the top of the needle, and then you can just put them on the slide, fix them, and see it under the microscope. Fine needle aspiration cytology is done in cases where the lesions are deep seated lesions. In deep seated lesions, we use FNAC. which are these deep seated lesions. For example, suppose there is a tumor in the deep lobe of the parotid gland. Suppose there is a tumor in the deep lobe of the parotid gland. In such cases, we cannot do the incisional biopsy. Then we need to do the fine needle aspiration cytology. Okay. The only disadvantage of doing fine needle aspiration cytology is, suppose you are checking for the lesion in the deep lobe of the parotid gland, and suppose that lesion is a malignant one, suppose it's a mucoepidermoid carcinoma and the deep lobe of the parotid, but while you take out the needle, there might be metastasis of the malignancy. So that is a disadvantage of using fine needle aspiration cytology. So here the answer is exfoliative cytology. Which of the following is a representative section of the lesion? The representative section of the lesion. As I told you, the best thing, whenever the lesion is above more than 1 centimeter in size, you have to do incisional biopsy. Whenever, wherever it is possible, go for incisional biopsy. Incisional biopsy will be the only thing which will be a representative section of the lesion. And whenever you are taking an incisional biopsy, you should take some part of the normal tissue as well in your biopsy or in that tissue specimen, so that to differentiate between what is normal and what is abnormal. Okay. So the representative section of the lesion you can get only in incisional biopsy. Punch biopsy, I have told you that the problem is, again in punch biopsy, that there might be destruction of the lesion or the cells. So it is will not actually represent or completely represent the section of the lesion. Similarly, in exfoliative cytology, only some scrapings are taken. Actually, in excisional biopsy, it is not a representative section, because the whole lesion you are removing. So it is not representing, it is total, in toto. So the answer is B, that is incisional biopsy. Now cultures from the oral cavity is obtained by, now if there is any pus discharge from the any fistula, or if any from the sinus tract, now if you want to take, or if there is any space infection or an abscess and you need to take the cultures, now there is one test which is called as cultural sensitivity test, or CST. In cultural sensitivity test, what we do is, there is one test tube, and inside that test tube there is one swab. The swab is put inside the test tube, and it is done, the autoclaving is done of the test tube, and then we need to remove that swab, and thorough sterilization protocol has to be followed, otherwise the bacteria from the surrounding may also get incorporated along with that pus cells, and your diagnosis may be not be exact that what you wanted. So to properly take the swab and the pus on that particular swab, and by following all the thoroughly the sterilizing protocol, again you have to put it inside that, and you seal that, and then you either you can fix it with the culture primary media, or you have to take it to carry it, or transporting medium has to be there to transport it from the clinic or the hospital to the laboratory. Okay, so the cultures from the oral cavity, either you can take the swab, as I have told you, you can take the swab on that cotton which is there, which is already sterilized, or you can also take it with the help of a needle. We call it as aspiration cytology. So you can just aspirate that contents, the pus or maybe some fluid, and you aspirate them, and then you seal them, and then you send it to the laboratory. So you can, these are the two ways how you can take the cultures from the oral cavity. So gathering exudative as well as aspiration with a needle, both 1 and 2. So C is the answer. Okay, so there is next question. is who discovered Australian antigen test? Again, it's a very direct type of question, and you can see here the various four names are given here, and you have to choose the correct name. Unless until you know the name, you cannot